All right. Once again, we have three movies. It was three movies last week, right? Yeah. Okay. And yes, it could have been four, but we have to spread some things out.
Next week will be four.
Yes. But in the meantime, we have these three, and we're going to start with Money Monster. Yet another movie starring George Clooney and Julia Roberts. Which is, what, the Ocean's movies and Confessions of a Dangerous Mind.
Mm.
I feel like there's so many more. Maybe not, unless something's totally slipping my mind. But this time, they are teamed up with Jodie Foster, who is strictly directing. And, yeah, it's basically... Somebody yesterday, I saw referred to it as Inside Man meets the King of Comedy. I get the Inside Man vibes, but I get the King of Comedy comparison, but that's kind of pushing it.
I got more, like, serious Airheads vibes. Like, coming through the ceiling, and then the gun, and...
This is not a movie like Airheads. Don't listen to that.
Well, and so, like Airheads, I liked both movies, so there you go. That's the only way it's compared.
So, George Clooney stars in one of those shows that you kind of flip by and you know is there, but you never actually watch.
Something on CNBC during afternoons.
Only he's real stylish about it because he's played by George Clooney. He has a very, he has a lot of showmanship about this.
He has fly girls, literally.
And he basically tells you what stocks are good and what aren't and stuff like that. But due to corruption and Dominic West, a disgruntled dude who is Jack O'Connell, who was Unbroken and Startup and 71 and all that stuff. Getting really big as time goes on. And with Unbroken, it's clear that he really likes being directed by actresses, apparently.
Mm-hmm.
With the Oscar-winning actresses, no less. And I was a little concerned about the opening, because, like I said, Clooney's character has a whole showmanship about this show. And we're kind of building up, we know a serious thriller is coming. And he's doing his George Clooney thing, and Julia Roberts is doing her Julia Roberts thing. And then suddenly, rap music, and dancing, and all that, and my immediate... No, don't get the wrong idea, I'm just telling you, my immediate thought when I saw this was, oh shit, this is how The Boss started.
Oh no, don't even go there.
I got really scared.
No.
With The Boss, it was more akin to the shittiness of the movie. But here, it's within the show that's inside the movie. So technically, it's not actually the movie that has a dance number in it.
It adds to the substance of the character this time around.
So, that's fancying it up a little bit. But
I like this movie a lot, okay?
Another thing it was throwing me was, I don't know if it's just Jodie Foster is in the subconscious when you compare it to Inside Man, regardless of the hostage situation, obviously. The real vibe I was getting was John Q.
Mm-hmm.
More than anything, like even more than Inside Man. So I guess I go as far as to say your opinion of this movie probably depends on your opinion of John Q. That's how close they are. Except this one's all about the problems in the financial system as opposed to the health system. So
right.
It's the same. It feels like the same thing when you're watching. And yeah, this is another one of those cases where everybody loves. I think it's one of those cases where somebody heard one person say it, and then everybody was like, oh my god, that's brilliant. And then everybody in the world latched onto it. And that is, anytime George Clooney's on screen, he's playing himself. That's what everybody fucking says. And this is one of those cases where... Well, that's the thing, though, is... George Clooney plays, you know, these really suave characters and all that. But when you actually see him in real life, In person. When you really see him being George Clooney... He's actually, like, he's a very goofy guy.
Oh yeah, totally.
much like, well, this character, you know, you kind of get the vibe with the way his show is. But the way he's kind of, he kind of has this, you know, likable arrogance about him, which is something really hard to pull off, that probably only George Clooney could, with the exception of maybe one or two other people. So I never really, you know, a huge George Clooney fan.
Oh yeah, same here.
He's got a couple of shit things out there, you know, like Leatherheads and stuff, but there's mostly every actor.
Leatherheads is not that bad.
Mostly every actor has their Leatherhead. Maybe I wouldn't hold it against him as much if he wasn't the director of that movie.
I defend that movie to people, actually. I liked it.
So, Julia Roberts gets a really good part here, too, where she's basically the one that has to control, because she's the director of the show, so she ultimately has to direct the situation when one of O'Connell's things is to not turn the cameras off. Yeah, my immediate thought was, okay, the plot is clearly going to be that they broadcast this to everybody, but how the fuck do they not immediately turn the cameras off? And then it's like, they do turn the cameras off, he just forces them to be put back on. That's how it goes. And I like the detail that a lot of people, when they're watching it, think it's part of the show.
Yeah.
So that's why nobody... the cops show up immediately, which is good. But, like, when we see all the viewers watching it around the city, people think it's the show, because the show is so...
over the top.
Yeah.
What's the stunt this week? Yeah. And then it's like, oh god, this is real, because he hits him with a gun, and he sees in the background, and next thing you know, they're like, we gotta really go and do something about
this. Yeah, because there was that security guy where he was like, yeah, I'm just, okay, I'm sure it's, and then he's like, oh shit, this is, okay.
Took him getting hit by a gun in order for them to realize it was real.
A lot of it is a pretty decent thriller. With some, you know, real suspenseful moments in it, and some good performances being thrown around. Mainly the, I don't really think about it, but I don't know if Jack O'Connell's accent is going to bother people, because I don't know that he is, I can't think of a time he's tried American before this.
it fits the character, though. Obviously.
But the thing about it is that this movie also has, I don't know, I struggle how to put this. It tries to be funny quite a few times for such a dire situation, because it's kind of a real-time thing, kind of like Phone Booth, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
And so in that, with the whole real-time thing, you got to kind of keep the suspense kind of constant. And really, it kind of always has to be present, what's at stake and what problems lie ahead and stuff like that. Sometimes you want to throw comedy in to break the tension and all that, but I don't know if it's necessarily that this isn't the type of movie where you should be breaking the tension, or if it's the way they chose to break the tension. Because there's a lot of comedy in this movie that just feels weird in this type of thing. One thing that jumped out to me immediately was the sex scene.
Yeah, it's very strange. It was really weirdly placed.
What is this? And because they were talking about the erectile cream before that, and it's... okay, I was waiting for that to pay off. That's... And there's a lot of, also the way they do the, I get it for realism. Don't get me wrong, I do get it. But the use of modern media, wasn't always hitting me in the right way. I sometimes thought it was a little odd. Like, it's the, instead of, like, after a while, instead of, like, you know, news, where like, on TV, we start seeing, like, internet news. And then there is a very, it's funny, don't get me wrong, but there is a very interesting use of vines in, like, the last scene of the movie.
Yeah, it was funny, but it felt weird.
That they ended the movie on that, too, was weird.
It actually the only laugh that it got in the theater.
It's like, that's yeah, I mean, yeah, I don't know. But, because it's clear with the R rate, this could have very easily been PG-13, but they made sure they threw more than enough fucks in it to get that R rating. So, they were clearly going for, like, an adult audience. Which makes it even weirder to me that, the sex scenes are thrown in for comedy's sake, and after all the suspense and all, like, the, you know, the serious themes it wants to touch on, we end on comedic Vine videos right before it ends. And it's like some rap song during the credits. I was praying to God it wasn't that annoyingly, ridiculously on the nose Bruce Springsteen song from the trailer.
You hate so much.
Like, I'm sure it's a decent song because it's, you know, him.
Yeah.
But I mean, in the context of this story, it's like, oh, that's way too on the nose to the point that I hate you for it. But that, okay. Another problem with this movie. I understand what it's going for and why it's doing the things that it's doing. But, you know, when you look at a movie like Phone Booth, a movie that, you know, just builds nonstop suspense for, like, 80 minutes completely. Another thing that broke the tension, the problem is not only is it the forced comedy that's there to break the tension, but this movie also was breaking the tension when it was trying to actually be a movie. Which basically I'm saying is, this movie's a lot more complicated than it needs to be. There's, like, after a while, there's a lot going on. And it's kind of... I feel like this movie would have benefited. Like, I'm not saying it has to be simpler, and you can't, you know, add on subplots that ultimately make a bigger picture. But I think this particular movie would have benefited from kind of staying small. But they really start dropping the plots on us after a while. The whole relationship with Dominic West and that woman. Did we really need that? Did we really need him bringing the chocolate from from the other country?
It was to break the tension that was going on, apparently.
Oh, but that's what the forced comedy is for. So, why are we... I don't know. And then there's, the scene where they bring his, girlfriend into it. Which is a very interesting... Because they do... Like, I won't say, but, there's stuff in the writing that's actually kind of cleverly put in there. That starts to make O'Connell's character sympathetic, to the point, I mean, yeah, but he's there basically representing the people, so you know they're gonna make him sympathetic in one way or another, but probably more so than you're expecting, to where, like, it's kind of, you kind of see him, and you're like, well, he's clearly our antagonist, even though he's, you know, got a message that everybody will, you know... That's, you know, he's basically doing on TV to an absolute extreme what people need to be saying and stuff like that. just bringing out the corruption and the lies and all that. As long as you don't use the word glitch, that's what you, that's then you'll be fine. It is very... there are those moments, but you can probably expect where it's kind of, like, preachy. and he might as well put a podium in front of O'Connell when he's doing some of his angry monologues. perhaps some Martin Luther King gesturing. Yeah. Honestly, the main thing that was really throwing me off was, there's way too many kind of inappropriate comedy moments that really, yeah, it almost, like, after a, sometimes you, like, question what genre you're even in when you're watching this. but the sad thing is, I really feel like there's clearly something in this movie that could have been great. Almost like, I don't know, like O'Connell's talking could have been, I mean, that's not to say that network's not preachy, but, for, you know, O'Connell to have like a Peter Finch quality to his performance. But there's too many things in this movie that keep it from, you know, being something that it really could have been. So, yeah. It's still fine. Like, I can still say I recommend it to people. It's just, it's definitely not the movie that it could have been, for sure. I would have subtracted probably a couple of storylines. But that's just me. And I wouldn't have brought up, like, you know, erectile cream and having sex scenes in it for the sake of comedy, no less. It's just weird. Okay. Our second movie is The Darkness. A movie that I wasn't even aware of. What's the marketing on this?
Nothing.
Because I wasn't, I really wasn't aware of this until I asked you what movies were coming out in Money Monster.
I don't really see, like, various, I don't see commercials anymore, so okay, I barely see this.
What is the difference between his normal company and Tilt? Is there?
I think Tilt. It's like a subsidiary, basically.
Okay. Well, anyway, The Darkness is a PG-13 horror movie. Congratulations. You know everything you need to know about it.
And after something like The Green Inferno being the first one from Tilt, I mean, that's a lot to live up to. And they're doing Incarnate, which looks decent, too.
Giving The Green Inferno an awful lot of credit.
It's better than some of the other stuff I've seen recently when it comes to horror.
Okay. Well, the movie has a couple things going for it before it starts. Stars Kevin Bacon. That's okay. And if I'm not mistaken, the director's the guy that did Wolf Creek. Which I know Wolf Creek's like an acquired taste, but
yep.
I've always kind of been on board with it. And so I was thinking, oh, okay, it's a PG-13 horror movie. We know exactly what we're in for. And we are. But being the director of Wolf Creek, I was thinking, I don't know, this guy seems to know, like, what the slow burn is and all that, because Wolf Creek is really slow. For a torture porn movie, Wolf Creek is, like, serious slow burn.
Yeah.
and so I was like, okay, we get that director to do a PG-13 horror movie with all the cliches and the fun stuff in it. Let's see what we're in for. I'm a little curious. And our slow burn is we have two couples with Kevin Bacon and Rada Mitchell, and then Matt Walsh and Jennifer Morrison, who you probably know from House. I think she was Kirk's mom, too, in Star Trek. So they're friends, and they're in, what, the Grand Canyon.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have the spirits were here, and, oh, don't take them home, but you'll probably take them home. and what's funny about this is I kind of thought, since both of them were there, and it was the other kid that was, like, egging them on, and saying, like, yeah, there's ghosts here, you know, I kind of thought it was going to be, like, a double thing. Like, we're going to cut back and forth, and both families will be dealing with stuff. And then we'll see how each one reacts differently, and if there's some kind of convergence. And if it's nope, we just never, ever see that other couple ever again. They're like best friends with this couple. We just never see those people again. so we're good. There's even a scene after the whole thing is ended when they, like, part ways. And I was like, if I had been thinking of it, I would have said, oh, there go those characters forever, bye. I don't know, that might have been Jennifer Morrison sitting with her in the very last scene. But I didn't get a good look, because it was from a distance.
Could have been. I've given up by then, so.
But, no, we only focus on one couple, because, God forbid, we go out of the normal realm, right? just even a little bit. Would that not have been more interesting, though, to see if the... I mean, not in this movie, because this movie would have just... It would have been like, let's see how the families react differently, and we can compare how they
cut back and forth, how they deal with different, like, ones from the country, ones from the city, something like that.
Yeah, this movie wouldn't have done that, though, because this movie
No, not at all.
This movie would have been, this couple's doing all the cliches, and then so is this couple. it's the same shit. There's really no difference. But no, we just have to watch one person. Don't you love the little foreshadowing that, when they're on their way home, he's watching Paranorman?
I thought that was nice.
And then later on, she's watching, like, some Porky Pig cartoon or something with ghosts in it. It's like, no wonder they're haunted. All they do is watch fucking shit with ghosts in it.
I'm honestly surprised they weren't watching, like, Children of the Corn or something.
And basically, so, getting back to this point, or finally. Being the director of Wolf Creek, I was like, okay, how are they going to slow burn this? They only have, what was it, an hour 32 they were working with. And PG-13 horror is not gonna hold off for that long. No, it's gotta be screaming in your face very soon. But let's see how they handle this. So there's typically going to be character establishment and stuff like that. Well, let me tell you how well they establish these characters. The dialogue we get, to really get to know these people is their opinion on Bear Grylls.
Yeah, that felt weird.
It's like the whole conversation.
Realize that would have been a Revenant joke if it would have been a little bit later.
That's where I thought they were going, but
same
then,
here.
But then they brought up Bear Grylls. I was like, oh yeah, that's where they took that.
Okay.
Maybe this was shot before the Revenant's popularity or something.
I'd say so.
But anyway, and so here's another way they established their characters very well. It was a long time before I realized that kid had a problem. I legit thought that kid was normal.
Mm.
And then it got to the point where they were in the kitchen. And Kevin Bacon's walking through and he's going to work. And he's like, okay, you be good for mommy now. And I was like, how the fuck old is this kid? did he say, you be good for mommy now? This kid's like, what, 12? No. At about the halfway point, I mean, eventually it becomes clear he's got a problem, and, like, Lucy Fry, like, keeps hinting at it, like it's some big secret. Halfway through the movie, they finally drop the word autism.
Yeah, I didn't think they were actually going to say it. I thought they were just going to leave it the
elephant
in the room.
It's like they were keeping it shrouded for some reason.
Yeah.
And if you're easily offended when it comes to that kind of material, you're probably not going to like when this movie takes the turn of some spirits are seen and brought forth strictly by kids with autism. I don't know if that's touchy for people or...
I'm positive it is.
I was just like, I have a feeling. I mean, I don't, you know, get offended by stuff like this, but it's like, I have a feeling somebody is. So anyway, we just start off immediately. He's got those rocks that he finds at the Grand Canyon. He puts them in his bag. And Kevin Bacon's like, okay, well, we're going to take your bag. I'm going to do this. And of course, you know, the kid could freak out and say, like, you know, don't do that. That's mine. And stuff like that. Or leave it. Or whatever.
I believe he growled at them.
But no, it's a PG-13 horror movie. So when the kid screams, so does the music.
Of course.
Just when he's grabbing his goddamn backpack. This movie's not waiting for anything.
Nope. It only has an hour and 20 minutes.
Great. Wonderful. This is sure to be a fun ride. So, we get all the bullshit. We get faucets that turn themselves on. Ooh, what is this, fucking Dark Skies again? And then we get the moment where she's in the attic. And I swear to God, the dude walks by the frame. We get fucking that shot. And just all, basically any of the shit you can think of. There are two, count them, two attractive blondes in this movie. Do we? Are we getting showers and baths? Do I hear showers and baths? Anybody? Anybody want to take any bets? Are there showers and baths? Yes, there are fucking showers and baths. So, and, you know, investigating noises in the dark. Just because. This is one of those movies, if you don't like stupidity, you're doomed. This is one of those movies where it becomes more and more apparent that this is something supernatural. And it's like, you know, this is just weird stuff, and just, oh, there's weird smells, and oh, the faucets keep turning themselves on, and then, oh, there's nothing, and then, oh, shit, there's something paranormal going on. And it's like, oh, I'm doing all my research on the internet, because that's, you get that. If you don't have a character actor, you have the internet. A lot of movies put both in there, but something is going to explain to you where this comes from, and typically it's the internet.
That video had like 35 views during the whole movie.
And it was, and this is completely established now. It is very likely something supernatural, something horrible is going on, the shit keeps going down, you have a kid with autism that's completely out of control, because it gets increasingly more just wild for everybody. The daughter's kind of unhinged too, but we'll get to that. So, at a very late point in the movie, when all this stuff has already been established, what happens? Kevin Bacon has to go have a business dinner with Paul Reiser, and Ronald Mitchell absolutely positively must join him. So the parents are going to leave the house for the night, leaving the kids by themselves, when all this shit has been established. Nice. So, Bacon's character was getting a little, I don't know what his deal was, because he obviously has a very, you know, he has an attachment to the kid. Not just because he's his father, but they... But they have, like, there's something in particular, a closeness, with them. And that, so, the kid goes to stay with this woman, and then, I think it's his grandma, actually.
I hate this.
And he tries to kill her cat. So, Kevin Bacon shows up, and they're like, your son tried to kill the cat. And Bacon's response is to shake his head and say, nope. Would not happen. Would never, ever happen. Absolutely not. That is absolutely false. I refuse to believe anything you're telling me right now. And he goes over to comfort the kid. Very next day, the very, very next day, the kid starts a fire. Bacon gets super pissed and says, this has got to stop! What has got to stop, Kevin Bacon, since you were so under the impression he was not trying to kill the cat yesterday? What has to stop that you are suddenly so keen on stopping now? Okay, fine. It took almost setting the house on goddamn fire to make Kevin Bacon go, there's something afoot here.
Pretty much.
So, I was talking about the character establishment. Well, we finally do get character establishment pretty late into the movie. We've got Kevin Bacon had an affair, Ronald Mitchell's an alcoholic, and the sister's bulimic. These are all subplots related to nothing, introduced about 50 minutes into this hour and a half movie. I get it if you finally want to do some character establishment, but you're a little too fucking late. Who cares anymore? It's okay. Before, when their lives were relatively normal, I could see, oh, by the way, the sister's bulimic, and the wife's an alcoholic, and Kevin Bacon's having affairs. Why is this coming out when the fucking ghosts come out? Not only that, but long after they have. Why is that relevant now? And they build it up, and it's, you kind of think maybe, possibly, it's gonna have bearing on something, because this was weird. Directors seem to think that the absolute most important person in a horror movie is the composer. Which I can see that outlook.
Right.
but not for movies like this, where they decide that finding out that the sister is bulimic, which is no way really deeming supernatural. That's just her. That's just her character. But regardless, this reveal is accompanied by horror music. Like, this seems inappropriate. That's it. I'm just getting such inappropriate vibes from this. And it's when we find out how she's been covering it up, that's pretty fucked up. But not horror music kind of fucked up. that seems just flat out insensitive, really. And but, you know, whatever. There is one scene in this movie that might make you go, the only trouble is it's pretty much a scare that was taken from Paranormal Activity 3. So that's the best you've got. That's the best you got to work with. I'm talking about, the kid likes to play, you know, they decided, we gotta do something. We gotta make ourselves a good horror movie. What are we gonna do? Let's grab a scene from The Conjuring real quick. Let's play hide and seek.
Of course.
So what he does is he just grabs a blanket and he throws it over himself. And then she, you know, pretends he's not there, and then she pokes him in there. You found me and shit. So then later on, she finds a towel on the ground, with a small bump in it. It looks like there's only a head under there. But for some reason, she's under the impression that that's him. this thing is like the size of a head, and she's like, ooh, that's him hiding.
He's sunk into the floor somehow.
I don't know. And then when she pokes it, it just kind of sinks down. And that makes you kind of go, ugh. But then it was like, that kind of reminds me of the scene in Paranormal Activity 3 when the sheet just kind of dropped. It kind of felt, you know, derivative a little bit.
You love those buzzwords.
It's just a little bit. That's an actual word.
Yes, but people have
driven... You are the buzzword person.
People have driven it into the ground nowadays.
Okay, it took from Paranormal Activity 3. That sounds so much better, doesn't it?
It took from that movie.
There is one... there's a scene that seems very oddly placed where they finally decide they're going to stay at a hotel. And this is, like... There's only, like, 20 minutes of the movie left when they do this. And them walking into the hotel lobby and getting a room is a scene that is played for laughs.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, why are we playing for laughs when there's 20 minutes to go? This is when you bring in Zelda Rubinstein right about now.
Yeah.
But okay. However, there is one laugh in that scene, though, when they're talking about when Ronald Mitchell's looking for a Bible. And Kevin Bacon's saying that they don't put Bibles in hotels anymore because of the whole, they don't want to seem like they're just about all about one religion and stuff. And Ronald Mitchell's response is, oh, Jesus. And Kevin Bacon just goes, not anymore. I thought that was funny.
Yeah.
So, yes. And another problem this movie has that a lot of these movies have are some really big promises. Of course, we have to bring in, like, the psychics and shit. The ones that fight off, you know, the people and all that. And because we just gotta hit every single cliche, we cannot leave one unturned.
Of course not.
So, we're getting big promises from these people saying, are you religious? And it's like, well, you know that God that you pray to, right? It's like, yeah, he's not gonna help you. Like, this is beyond that. And we're like, holy shit, what are we dealing with? We're dealing with every PG-13 horror movie ending ever. Wow, you really... Yeah, I really felt like God was dead watching that climax. You really put the fear in me. They're shadows. And then you put rocks down and they go, oh shit!
And they just... Then it turns into the Poltergeist remake.
God cannot save you, but if you line up some rocks just right, you might be okay. Oh, shit. Okay. So, yeah, I think I kind of touched on the, yeah. There's just nothing new here, and this is just all old, played out shit that everybody's tired of, and I feel like it's getting to be found footage. Like, I just feel like I'm reviewing the same movies all the time and saying the same things, and this is exactly what you think it is.
And its audiences are not necessarily going to cling to it either, because when we were walking out, everybody was hating it.
Yeah, so I think people are clearly tired of, like, these movies used to do, like, really well. I think when Ouija came out, it was, like, number one at the box office.
Oh, jeez.
I think that was just due to lack of competition, because movies like this don't do what they used to do.
I mean, we're a month away from The Conjuring. If you want to watch horror, save your money.
I think it's, I think your best bet is coming out, like, on Halloween or something. But even then, people just aren't into this anymore. They haven't been for quite some time.
There's still, like, the stuff like Insidious and The Conjuring will still grab them, but that's about it.
People still go.
Oh, yeah.
A little bit. I think that's mainly fans of the genre that are, like, hoping it's going to be, like, some hidden gem or something.
Yep.
It never is. Like, it almost never is. Like, but you keep trying. Just keep trying. Just... Yeah. I don't know. Like I said, it just feels like horror, they only think is in two directions right now, with the found footage and the... Apparently PG-13 horror and found footage never cross over, because 95% of most found footage movies are people screaming fuck.
Yeah.
That's how they haven't crossed
that's
over
That's reality. Yet. Let's scream.
That's how they haven't crossed over yet, so...
Yeah.
Just don't bother. Because if you go, then that's going to give the movie a little money, and that'll make people say, well, let's just keep doing it.
June 10th, just go watch The Conjuring 2.
I know Juan's name's on and everything, don't get your hopes up yet.
Oh, I've got complete hopes on The Conjuring. I mean, come on. It's not going to be Annabelle.
So, okay. And our last movie is Hello, My Name Is Doris. Sally Field's indie movie. Sally Field going for that Independent Spirit Award.
Of course.
And this is, an interesting, Michael Showalter is the director.
Sweet.
And wait, you didn't know that?
No. That's amazing. That makes me even more wanting to see it.
And Doris, who is Sally Field, obviously, is this very meek older woman who's living in her office. She's kind of the carryover. Like, she was in the office forever, and then there was a whole bunch of changing and transferring and all that, and she just somehow stayed behind.
She's Milton.
When everything got all new and younger.
Awesome.
And so she meets Max Greenfield, he's the new guy here, and immediately takes a liking to him, but she's Sally Field, and he's Max Greenfield, who's, like, in his... late 20s or early 30s. So there's an issue here. And the fact that she's just meek in general. So she's just... She meets him in the elevator, and she can't even, like, look at him or say anything. So she just kind of has to, like, bug out when he's talking to her. and we know... I can understand if some people think that Doris is a little too weird. There is... Because she takes a liking to him, but there's only so much she can do because she's just so confined within herself. So when he turns around in the elevator, she takes a pencil out of his pocket and basically keeps it as a keepsake because it was his pencil. And she, like, treasures it. It's depending on how you take this kind of character. But she makes it very likable. We'll get to that. The thing I was thinking about going into it was... I was thinking if it was, like, a movie that was strictly devoted to Susan Sarandon's character in Jeffy Lives at Home.
Yeah.
Only it's it's a younger guy instead of a woman that finds her attraction. And speaking of that, yeah, I was getting a real, like, Showalter's the director, and I get that. This has such a Duplass Brothers vibe. Man. Like, just all over completely.
That sounds great.
Only without the zooming in and zooming out, which is good. and there is, it is really funny. There's a hilariously suggestive scene involving a posture ball. And how he has to, she's sitting on it because her knees are weak, and he has to pump it with his bike pump, and just the dialogue and while this is going on. and then there's the whole thing where she makes a fake Facebook page so that she can figure out his interests. And like I said, it depends on how you take this character. It could be taken in a whole different way. This woman might be kind of crazy, but it's... but of course she gets into the electronic music that he's into just because it's him, and it's kind of hilarious to see Sally Field, not only Sally Field, but Sally Field as this character, trying to dance to this electronic music and figure out what exactly she's supposed to do. and yeah, a lot of this movie just really, really works. Max Greenfield is, I only watched New Girl for a little bit. But the movies I've seen him in and the interviews and stuff, he's got charm out the asshole. Like, this guy is just full of charm, and it really, really works for this part. And and that's the thing, too, is, typically movies like this, when people kind of grow, a potentially unhealthy attraction to another person, typically the character development is so poor, you kind of wonder why that person liked that person so much, because we don't really get much of that other person. We just have to take the main character's word for it. Mm-hmm. But he can really... You can tell why she likes him so much, because the character himself is just really, really likable. and that's kind of the thing in regards to it being an odd lead character, is Showalter also did a movie called The Baxter. That I know had a lead, he played the lead character in it, I think. And I so often confuse him and Michael Ian Black, I don't remember who's who.
Well, considering the fact, both from Stellan, both from The State, that makes sense.
But I think he's the director and also the star of The Baxter. And I know the lead character he played in that, I remember liking him in that movie. And I know that his character was very, the criticisms were often, how much you like the movie depends on if you can put up with the lead character. and so, yeah, he seems to be kind of good at that, making a character that you either grow attached to or is very off-putting. But I found Doris really likable. She's just very... It's just her surroundings and just kind of the way her life has gone that she's just a very, very introverted person. And she really can't do anything about it because it's just the way she is. She's the type where, when she's reading, she wears glasses on her glasses. That's... and that's the thing, is... Another thing that kind of keeps her from going into that creepy territory is that, they just make the character really funny. Like, anytime she does something kind of absurd or a little off the rails, they make it into a funny scene as opposed to, holy shit, this woman's crazy kind of thing. And through making her funny, we realize she's just kind of misunderstood and doesn't quite know how to really function, in regards to her surroundings. And so there's more of an awkwardness than a creepy and weird kind of thing. And of course, we get to a point to where you kind of know that the movie's going to go in a sad direction after a while. Like, there's a particular moment where they start hanging out a lot, and they start getting kind of close, and it's, like, halfway through the movie, and so you're, like, with this much of the movie left, something really emotionally draining is going to happen to her before it's over. and that's the thing, is when that, there's one particular moment that we know is inevitably coming, but the way they handle that is really, really good and really unexpected. Because you kind of expect it's going to be the ultimate dramatic moment of the movie and send us in the direction we're ultimately going to go. But they really don't overdo it at all. It's just kind of a... characters get kind of disappointed with each other, as opposed to doing the classic blow up, I'm not talking to you thing. They're just kind of like, wow, that sucks, and shit. it's very underplayed when it comes to that kind of stuff, which makes it feel more real. Because you just dread the inevitable movie blow up where the characters get overly angry and stop talking to each other, and you're like, this is fucking boring, and I hate these characters, and I wish they would stop. But no, these characters are really, really easy to latch onto and really like. And that's really what's most important in a movie like this, because that's what the whole movie is. There's these two characters, basically, mainly her and her, just her kind of family, too. There's a nice dynamic there. Steven Root plays her brother, and they have some really good scenes. There's a really emotional scene towards the end they have together that both of them are really good in, and I would really love to see Sally Field get awards attention for this outside of the Spirit Awards. But I'm afraid it's going to end up being not only too small, but too early, which is probably an issue. I think this was premiering at film festivals last year, and a lot of people were kind of looking at it like it was going to come out last year, and then it never did. And then it just did now, this past month, so. Yeah, I'd really like to see it get some attention, but I think it might be too. She would definitely, totally, completely deserve it, too. Like, this is. It's hard to compare. I'm going back to her last nominated performance with Lincoln, it's kind of hard to compare the two characters, but. Yeah, this is definitely. This is on par with her best stuff. And she's been doing good stuff for a long time. She won her first Oscar in 1979. That's how long she's been doing great stuff. And this is right up there with her best stuff, I would say. It's just such a... The whole... Like, not just the characters, but the whole movie just has this really lovable quality to it. And, yeah, like I said, it just depends on how you feel about the lead character. But she really worked for me, and I think that's definitely an ode to... mainly to her, but the writing is not to be shunned here either. So, yeah. This all came together quite nicely.
Yeah, I can't help but mention the irony of the fact that Steven Root is also in this movie when we were mentioning that. Sounds good. So ends another edition of AJ's Movie Reviews. Next week, we've got Angry Birds. Yeah, looking forward to that. Not really. We have Neighbors 2, and we have... Nice Guys, which I've been really looking forward to. And we actually have Green Room going to be on that video, too. So stay tuned for that. Before we take it home, we have some ratings to go over. Money Monster?
2.5.
The Darkness?
1.5.
Hello, my name is Doris.
3.
Figured that's where we were going. So stay tuned to the Popcast Network this weekend. Special video coming out tomorrow. Not really special, but it's something different. And Sunday, brand new verses. Your cryptic comment is invisible. Imaginary friend.
Oh, yeah. That's the next one.
Imaginary friend, yes. Yes, you were giving away the one. I'll tell you that on Sunday. So that being said, I want to thank you guys and girls out there for watching. AJ, any parting words?
That's it.
Happy Friday the 13th.